Even in the very beginning, He is who He is. Could you say amen?
Amen.
In the Old Testament, we can hear that God is love, for God is love. But do you believe that in the Old Testament, God is love as well? I do. God is the God of justice, and God is the God of mercy, the God of compassion. And we see Him right from the very beginning, even after the fall of man. And so it will be good, and I'm interested, and in fact, it is a joy for me to look at this passage, and in the light of the blessings of who we are, in the Lord Jesus, faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. And so we are going to dwell on this passage, and we are going to relate this even to our Christian experience, and backed up by what it said in the Scripture. Okay, thank you, Ren. Probably you are very much aware of what is going on in the internet, that there is a heated exchanges of words regarding a congressman, Congressman Boxer Manny Pacquiao, words on homosexuality. Now, some of these people who are interviewing him, and interviewing Christians, they just want to victimize, and then later on they are going to complain. If you are going to tell them the truth, they are not happy of it. So they ask Manny Pacquiao, who I believe he is a born-again Christian, and he is not afraid to say whatever, what he learned and what he saw in the Scripture. And he was asked about homosexuality. So of all things, why do they have to ask about homosexuality? They should have asked about politics. So when they have asked about homosexuality, people in the media, like television, people like Aisha Sigira, we call him Vice Ganda. No, he's not Ganda, Vice Pangit. Boy Abunda and others have reacted openly, exposing what is abuse. Our pastor friends have written lengthy reaction letters on it. But in the midst of all this, the truth in the Scriptures will be revealed that sin is a sin regardless of whoever practices it. This is what the Bible says, and it is the truth. Sin invokes and invites the judgment. But we are not becoming judgmental. That is only telling what the Bible says. Don't throw a stone on me because I said it. God said, there is no third sex in the Bible. Would you say amen?
Amen.
Only male and female. There is no hybrid human. Only cars. Some men may have flexible and pliable muscles, but they are still men. Some women may have tough muscles, but they are still women. Or even men may have tender voices, but still they are men. Or women may have tough voices, but they are still women. In marriage, the Bible says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife, and they will become one flesh. Genesis 2:24. That is what says in God's word. It's not for us to revise it. For this reason, it refers to that verse 23 where Adam received, he said, bone of my bones, flesh of my flesh. And that's why God said, for this reason, a man, this is the very reason of marriage. A father, a son, will leave his father and mother and cleave to his wife. There is no clearer statement than that. It is not a girlfriend. It is a wife. Distortion and modification of what God has done, created, said, and planned is sin, it is perversion, and it is corruption. In Genesis, do you know what that is, corrupting God's word? It is the serpent's idea. Now sometimes the serpent will use good things are beautiful. Yes, why Eve has been convinced? It is because, one, it is pleasing to the eye. It is good for food. But that is not what God has planned for them. So it is not being judgmental to read and reveal God's word on the matter. In fact, this is what the Bible says. And those who practice them deserve to die, even those who approve them. That is not my word. These are a phrase, a sentence in the book of Romans chapter 1. God has created man and woman in his likeness and image. That is why life is worth living. I think we're not going to have a problem as far as sex identity if you know who you are. You're not going to regret. Sana naglalaki na lang ako. Sana naging babae na lang ako. Sometimes we are going to do that, you know, for our own, or we think it is our advantage. God has allowed you to exist and live in this world just as you are. And God has already stated that God has planned for it. Be contented with it. God is wise. There are three divine natures, and part of it is divine nature. That's a divine nature. And the divine nature, actually, it's a knowing right and wrong. Where the devil said, he distorted it, yeah, you will become like God. He don't want you to eat that because you will become like God. What is that? It is knowing good and evil. The only problem is that we cannot handle it because we are not God. Three divine natures pass on to us that make us life worth living. One of it, last time was? What is that first one? God's nature that is in us that makes life worth living?
Love.
Love. Thank you, Susan. It's love. Without love, I don't know how we are going to live or not. Love makes life worth living. And the Lord God said, it is not good for man to be alone. I will make him a helpmate. I don't know if there will be marriage without. I think there is still, right? Because there was marriage before the fall of man. Love was already there. God has implanted in the heart of men. Number two, the second gift that God has given us so that life will become worth living is justice. Justice makes life worth living. Justice has been imminent, has been displayed by God, you know, after man had fallen into sin. If you will be able to find that in the first four chapters and even five chapters, you will be able to find the thread line and the concept of what justice is. At the outset, I'm going to say that God is just, when man had fallen into sin, God is just for allowing man to die and he is not going to live forever. Could you say amen? Amen. Do you know why? If you are going to live forever with the consequences of sin, how would you like that? Supposing you are going to live like the oldest man in the Bible, which is about 1,000 years, and you are going to reap the consequences of sin for all these years. Papayag ka ba? In fact, you're going to ask for God's mercy, Lord, kunin mo na ako. I don't want to live for 1,000 years. In fact, some of those people are already 100 years old and they're already moving like this and their prayer is that, Lord, kunin mo na ako. Take me home. Because this world where we are living, you know, God is just because this world has been cursed by sin. Cain said to the Lord, my punishment is more than I can bear. Oh, that's what he said. Today you are driving me from the land, and I will be hidden from your presence. I will be a restless wanderer on the earth, and whoever finds me will kill me. There's something interesting in this last phrase. When they will find me, they will kill me. He is afraid of being killed, but he has the nerve of killing his own brother. He did not even thought that being killed by someone is actually the result of is it justice, because he killed, he should be killed as well. Why will we be afraid of being killed, being wanderer by someone when he has the nerve of killing his own brother? But God is just. God did not even say, so you are going to die because you killed your brother. But he was the one who said it. He's afraid of being taken away from the presence of God, and once he will be a wanderer, somebody will kill him. But the Lord said to him, he said, no. Anyone who kills Cain will suffer vengeance 7 times over. Justice. Then the Lord put a mark on Cain so that no one will find him would kill him. Mercy. So Cain went out from the Lord's presence and lived in the land of Nod. It's east of Eden. East of Eden, probably that is where Pakistan is. If you live in Pakistan and Afghanistan, it is a very arid and dry land, isn't it? It's hard to live. Genesis chapter 4. Records 3 justice display, if not 4. Here I just want to point out, we have Cain and Abel offering worship. Offering in worship. God is just. God is just that he is going to reward and he is going to accept. Not only a hearty worship, but a worship that is right. Or a heart that is right in offering worship to him. Or the offering that you are going to have. It's not how much we are going to have, but it is the content of our heart. Cain murdering his brother, Abel. That's another justice being displayed there. And then Cain being dragged away from God's presence. What I'm trying to weigh in marrying, here's the other part of this. He said, Lamech married 2 women named Ada and Silpa, and Ada gave birth to Jabal, and so forth. Now, I look at this, you know, I don't know if it is really just to marry 2 women. Because if you are going to marry 2 women, you cannot love them equally. You don't have all the time, you are only one. You cannot split. Right? So it is not just. It's either you are going to treat the other one better and the other one is lesser. That's why God, what if you're going to say, Adam, you are so manly, broad shoulder, handsome, you are capable, everything is there, I'll give you 2 women. God did not make that, you know what is just. The life of Eve is as important as the life of Adam, and that is justice. God is perfect in his decision. So debate on that after that. That's why, but it is interesting to note how God brings justice and mercy in this situation. That's why in spite of all the sin that we are going to encounter, and I'm so happy that I'm going to live, and I have asked the Lord that I'm going to live 75 years already. Sabi ko, Lord, bigyan mo ako ng panahon. I just celebrated my birthday the other day. I have 3 days of birthday. Before my birthday, which is 18, 19, I need to celebrate my birthday. 20, birthday ko pa rin yun.
3 days.
And I have asked the Lord, I said, God, if you are going to just give me 75 years, and some of you over here are already past 75, in fact 85 or even more. And I'm going to ask God, Lord, that you are going to give me more years that I will be able to see my children and even my grandchildren be faithful in you. I don't know, God is just. And God is merciful. He answers prayer. Amen?
Amen.
While the Lord is love, He is also just and He punishes the guilty. Common expression, right? We learned that one, right? Indeed. The Lord applies justice in practicing His love. This is where many times men, we fail in practicing love, devoid of justice, or there's a little justice. Since sin is serious, your punishment is severe and capital. I was asked, Pastor, are you conservative or liberal? If I'm in the Philippines, I just told him I'm nationalistic. I said, I'm conservative. Do you believe in capital punishment? I said, yes. Because that is biblical. Said the soul that sin in each other. There is a fair balance between the offended and the offender. In the Bible, you will find that there is what we call the cities of refuge. The cities of refuge has been intended and been set by God for those people who have killed people unintentionally. Are you with me? So that is a plan of God. There are those people who killed unintentionally. If not, they are going to suffer the consequences of capital punishment. Unintentional. If you remember Moses, that he killed someone. And then after that, so he ran away, right? Okay. Now God often revealed His plan as plan, plain and simple. So you say amen? Now here is this. This is in the Bible. This is what I see. Faith that leads to obedience, disobedience reaps blessings. Amen? Claro yan. Unbelief that leads to disobedience and the result will be vengeance from God. That's why vengeance is mine. I will repay, says the Lord. God has set already the punishment. In our government, we have much lesser burden if we follow God's way of justice. Particularly here in America. We will not spend so much tax money in keeping this disobedient for years. You see, they say that it's only here in America where we have so many people in jail kept and sustained well for committing violent crimes. Like, for example, Peterson of Modesto. Una tayong lumayo sa Modesto na. Where he was talking to someone, his girlfriend, and he said, I'm here in Eiffel Tower in Paris. Why? Well, he's just in Modesto. And he killed his pregnant, beautiful wife. Where is he today? He's in St. Quentin. It's more than 10 years now, he's still in jail, enjoying the good food. You know, I was able to talk to one of these guards in St. Quentin. Those prison there, you give them a dessert, which is a pastry, a cookies. If it is broken, they don't eat. Which is how spoiled they are. They have a good food, they have a good gym, they have a guard, they have a health service, they have a lawyer. What else are you going to ask? You know, but the blood of his ex-wife and child are crying for justice. I cannot imagine the heartache and the disappointment of the family of Peterson's wife over the injustice in our government system. Those who are dead, they will be dead. Those who kill will seek for justice. So-called justice. Another example is a drunk driver killing poor people like one in Texas. A spoiled, drunk youngster killed poor people being kept for rehabilitation. We know that drunk driving is
Krishna is good, it's only who will die. But if you are going to kill many, that's not fair. Some of those who are dead, they are just eating in their house, and then all of a sudden, you know, the car will just run through their house.
Because of drunk driving.
Well, a little research in the internet I have done about injustice. It said that there are 10 injustices in our world today. And I'm going to talk about this in such a way that you will be able to appreciate, you know, the love of God. You will be able to appreciate that and also be able to, in spite of these things that makes heartache, that pains in our life, we will be able to appreciate it that without God in us, life is not worth living. So I like very much the introduction of the article that led me to look for their organization named CRU, C-R-U. And this is based in Indiana University. And I tried to research a little bit, and the founder of this is Bill Bryant. The organization internationally known as Campus Crusade for Christ. The research says, we live in a world of full of love, hope, joy, and redemption. But in the end, it is also full of heartaches and full of pain, full of sorrows, and full of despair. Ask yourself, what is injustice? Is it not standing up for what you believe in? Is it turning a blind eye to those hurt next to you? Or is it causing the hurt? Our world is filled with unjust actions every day that people don't know about. Have a lot of encouragement to take a stance on, and are simply not convicted to evoke change against it. One of those is poverty. In 2011, the homeless population estimate in Los Angeles alone, called the Skid Row, was 4,316. What? America. And we have this. It's called the richest nation in the world, the greatest nation in the world, but there is poverty. Now, oftentimes we are going to look at poverty outside of the United States. But there is poverty right here. And you know what the Bible says about poverty? Poverty is not all caused by the government or caused by someone else. Sometimes it is a decision, result of the decision we have made. And according to the Bible, poverty will always be around in this world. Remember what Jesus said? At the time when he was here, and Mary Magdalene poured out that alabaster bottle in him, and the disciples said, why don't we just have sold that one? It is so expensive. And Jesus said, the poor will always be with you, but you are not going to have me all the time. So make any richest country in the world, poor people will still be there. Why? It's a choice that they have made. Well, there are other countries. There's a lot of poverty, which is a result of the action of the leaders. Second, starvation. I mean, people in Africa, they said, who are starving for food? Here in America, there are still many people who are starving, even though they have a lot of food. And we have many food that we have just thrown away. This organization called DoSomething.org writes almost one in every 15 children in developing countries dies from hunger. It's a picture about black people. It is about in Africa. I think considering in Africa, we know that if there is corruption in the Philippines, we have a lot of corruption in the Philippines too. But in Africa, there's a lot of corruption. And they can afford to deprive these people. But those leaders, mind you, they are riding in the most beautiful cars in the world. It's just like we have a province. There is a governor in southern Philippines. Just outside the mansion of the governor surrounded by shantings. Starvation. Ang mga Pilipino lang hindi na-starve. Very practical yung mga Pilipino. Kung wala silang bigas, saging kakainin. Ilagay mo lang sa bundok, mayroon kamot eh. Mabuhay pa rin. Hindi naman silang marunong kumain ng kamot eh dito eh. Gusto nila, everything is ready. Gugutom din na. Three, an injustice is gender inequality. Martin Luther King said, injustice everywhere is a threat to justice everywhere. Most of this content of this one is from that organization, the article from that organization crew. They said that on January 22, 2014, the Indiana Times released this statement. A kangaroo court last Sunday decided that the victim be raped by 10 men as she had committed a crime by having an affair outside the community. The tribal heads had found that the sin of the 20-year-old woman can be only undone if she gets raped by 10 tribal men. And laws. Gender inequality is not just happening in India but around the world. Women are being regarded as objects. Rape is no issue. Women in India are being raped as instruments of war. They are purposely being preyed upon to prove a cause for strife and war. Isn't it that here in America they are crying, they said, that executives who are women receive less than executives who are men? That's when they're crying equality. It's always a cry for inequality, right? Anywhere we go.
Yeah.
You remember during the time of Jesus? The two disciples and the mother, he said, Lord, when you will be in heaven, how about my son? How about my son who will stay with you, you know, on the left and on the right? Now they don't hold in a right, these women don't hold in a right, in a power or a strength that ties them to being valued human life. Saudi Arabian women are denied driver's licenses. You remember the story that there is this woman from America, she went back and she just drove around in Saudi Arabia. Now in China, female babies are being killed because of their one-child policy and their preference for males. Salamat na lang itong mga apo ko na panganak dito sa US or else. Puro mga babae itong apo ko. Now in this practice of infanticide, it is common that fathers to take their child from the mothers and to kill them sacredly. Number four, injustice. Elderly. The elderly are often ignored, stereotyped as no longer competent for everyday tasks and looked down on as slow and intelligent. And like here in America. Because even if you are retired, you still want to work, you can still work in Walmart and be a greeter. Good morning. What can I do? Kaiser, you see these people who are volunteers, you see these people. You know, Eden was telling me about our kababayan, our Filipina. You know, she's already 75, she's still working as environmental, you know, papunas-punas doon sa Kaiser. At tumatagam ng $25 an hour. Di ba sarap yun, di ba? Papunas-punas. $25 an hour. Sabi niya, mas mabuti lang, eh, better that I'm doing this way than caring for my apo. And then she bought a new RAV4. How about that? It's better, right? Sometimes, pag-retire na natin, bigyan na lang tayo ng pauga-uga na sasakyan. Mauga-uga na lang tayo, uga-uga pa sasakyan natin. Maluwang na nga tuhod, maluwang pangungog nila. Our elders are our previous teachers, CEOs, innovators, and those who evoke change. But the outer appearance of them can easily smear the human perception of them into something useless and worthless. Yeah.
Leviticus chapter 19, verse 32 says, you shall stand up before the gray head and honor the face of an old man, and you shall fear your God. I am the Lord. As our children are our future, the elderly have produced the greatest moments of our past. I like that statement. This should be held high, respected, and loved.
Amen.
Kaya tama pala yung siyaya namin. Mano po. Mga matatanda, mano po. Tayong mga Pilipino, kahit nandito tayo sa Amerika, huwag niyong tawagin ng pangalan ang lolo. It's always daring, you know, to say, Lulo, huwag niyo akong tawagin. Abe, ulit sa saga sa akin. Number five. Widows! In India, widows are isolated, ignored, and are treated as if they are lower than anyone else. They are not shown pity, but rather harsh judgment. Widows are subjected to harsh treatment and poverty. Most spend their days begging for food at the temples, living day to day. They said, I believe that this is the research, the $31 and healthcare assistance they are given when their husband passes is not enough to live on. $31. Mas mahal pa kung saan yung sapatos doon sa Ross. Many widows in India are ignored, pushed to the side, and looked down on because they lack a man to take care of them. But in other countries, although not as severe as an apparent, widows are lost and full of sorrow. That's it. You remember that when Jesus died, son, Jesus introduced Mary to John. These women need to be embraced and loved. Amen?
Amen.
I know widows who are truly widows.
Yeah.
That's the word of Apostle Paul. And I hear in America there are widows who are not really widows. They intended to be widows, even though their husbands are alive. But if a widow has children or grandchildren, let them first learn to show godliness to their own household and to make some return to their parents, for this is pleasing in the sight of God. She who is truly a widow, left all alone, has set her hope on God and continues in supplications and prayers night and day. But she who is self-indulgent is dead even while she lives. Command these things as well, so that they may be without reproach. Number six, injustice, orphans. Okay, mag-adapt na kayo. Mag-adapt ng mga bata, right? The Congregational Coalition on Adoption Institute states here that in the U.S., 400,540 children are living without permanent families in the foster care system. 115,000 of these children are eligible for adoption, but nearly 40% of these children will wait over 3 years in foster care before being adopted. That's 4,540 children living without love, without family, with very small amount of hope and without the blissful innocence of playing in the sandbox or swinging on a swing without a care in the world. I remember that there's a boy who was interviewed. He said that in his lifetime, and he became a basketball player or a boxer. Oh, I remember that. Some of this prominent boxer. He transferred 5 times from one foster home to another. In the world, there is an estimated amount of 152 million orphans. Children deserve to be loved and cared for. They grow and learn in the household of love. Stephen Curtis Chapman, I was supposed to research who this guy is. Yes, he said, I did nothing to deserve God's love. In fact, I was living as an orphan without hope. Yet God chose to pursue a relationship with me, and through the death of his son Jesus, I was adopted into God's family. Amen. This is the most encouraging one. That regardless of your social status and your situation as family, if you have come to the Lord, you have come to a permanent, you have come into a relationship and being related or begin into a permanent family, which is the family of God. It is a family that will last up to heaven. Number three.
Seven. Racism.
Well, we cannot help being racist. All those, it says Muslims are not all terrorists. My hair is real. I am not colored, and so forth. We are not all Mexicans. I quote that one again. There's that one question in your SAT, right? This is high school, right? SAT, or when you are applying for colleges or filling out a job application, that makes you ask yourself, which maybe you're going to ask, does this really matter? There may be some variations stating, what is your ethnicity? What is your ethnic background? Or what race do you identify yourself with? That's why even there is a question about, how about the ethnicity of Filipinos? Are they Asians?
Asians.
Okay. They say they are Pacific Islanders. Our equivalent is we're equivalent to the Samoans, not Asians. Race is an issue. Our culture tries to pretend that it's not, but our minds can't help but compare the people with the stereotypes. Smart, dumb, truck driver, impoverished, blue collar, and so on. We associate them with race. In fact, in the Philippines, we have a joke with that one. Kung taga doon ka, ano mo? Ganito. Kaya naman pala ganyan ka. It's easy to identify yourself based on your race, but it's even easier to prejudge others. There's that song sung in Sunday school. It says, red and yellow, black and white, they are precious in his sight. Jesus likes the little children in the world. That's really all what that race is about. God loves us equally. It's identifying with culture, family, or certain countries, but it has nothing to do with potential, with success, or with what a person is capable of. Kaya kung minsan, pag ikaw ay Filipino engineer at kasama mo yung mga hawli, mga puti, you know, sometimes, you know, they look down on you. Sabi pa si Brother Raul, kung nasa Pilipinas ka lang, empleyado kita. Achievement, he said, has no color. Tama? Therefore, racism should not have any bounds to exist. Sabi Brother Raul, I told me about two jokes. Sabi niya daw na mayroong isang tao naghahanap ng nagkaroon ng brain tumor. Pagkatapos gusto niya ipapalitan yung kanyang brain at gusto niya yung pagiging matalino. So, bright. So sabi niya, he told about a race. Sabi niya, how about this race? Sabi niya, well, if you want to have a mind of these people, sabi niya, probably it costs you about 25,000. Sabi niya, mahal naman yan, yung 25,000. Sabi niya. How about ganito? Sabi niya, then it became global. Sabi niya, why is that? Tapos he mentioned when he raises, how about this? Sabi niya, it will cost you about 500,000 to change your brain like that. I said, why? Sabi niya, could you just imagine? I'm going to kill 150 people of this in such a way to find a brain, what you are looking for. Number eight, injustice, abuse. An African girl, I looked out in her window. She said, near an open classroom on the outskirts of Jalalabad in January 30, 2013. Afghanistan has only raised movements of peace over the past 30 years, its education system being undermined by the Soviet invasion of 1979, a civil war in 1990, and 5 years of the Taliban rule. Hate, strife, physical and domestic violence, and verbal abuse are the opposite of love. To physically or verbally abuse someone only serves one purpose, to treat someone whom a person deems lesser than himself. To be even more insignificant than how they see himself. It's all about power. It's all about justifying feeling good, justifying that it is something to deserve it. Indiana University, British International Staff, this is an organization. His name is Dante. He said, injustice comes out of idolatry of yourself. Pastor Bible says, don't think of yourself highly than others. Oh, the Bible says, he said, oh, no one anything except to love each other, for the one who loves another has fulfilled the law. For the commandments, you shall not commit adultery, you shall not murder, you shall not steal, you shall not covet, and any other commandment are summed up in this word. This word, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. Love does no wrong to a neighbor. Therefore, love is the fulfilling of the law. And I like that. We now need to talk about that. Life is worth living. Number 9, sex trafficking is injustice. 27 million people are slaves. Probably this one happened, the research was given, it's about 2011, something like that. That's about 5 or 6 years ago. They said 29 million people are slaves. They said that's a huge number. This researcher said that's more than 4 times the population of Indiana. So 5 million lang pala population ng Indiana. Right? 5 to 7 million. The population of California at this time is about how many? Hey, people of California.
Let's see.
The population of California has been changed at the time I arrived. Because at the time it was 44 million.
What, 16?
18.
When was that?
20 years ago.
38.8.
Huh? 38.8. Yes. I think the reality is many of the population here in California moved to other states. It is because here in the states are very expensive. In California are very expensive. Many have moved to Texas, Arizona, and so forth. Many seniors move out of California. They went into these places where the retirement money would make them live better than here in California. Slavery is a thief of choices, said Ryan Berg, a lead advocate against sex trafficking with the Arona Project. The Arona Project reaches these women. They teach them to value themselves, and they share the love of Christ, and they help. They help these women to get back on their feet. According to the Arona Project, each year, millions of women and children are trafficked for sex worldwide. In one of South Asia's largest red light areas, in deplorable conditions, there are an estimated 15,000 sex workers in a 2-square-mile area who are seen as nothing more than flesh for sale. Slavery is a very real opposition and a real injustice that deserves to be set right. So when you are treated as less than important, you are still human. When you are treated as less than worthy, you are still human. When you are treated less than your title, you are still human. But when you are treated less than the very thing you are born to be, you perish. According to this guy, Mr. Lampton. Number 10, war and grief. Every injustice in this world causes grief. Have you ever been in that moment, that place in your life where everything is filled with sadness? It looms over you like a dark cloud that you can't seem to escape? It's the pull on your heart, the weight, the heaviness, and the despair that makes you want to sit alone, lie in bed, cry, scream, pull your hair, and yell with every ounce of energy that you have. The researchers said that is grief. Every injustice in this world causes grief. It crosses the line between what is known as right and what is wrong. So injustice, even this, happened here in America. Right in our own very eyes, injustice is happening to many children who are born here in America today. About 40%, they said, the children who are born these days are out of wedlock. It is not just that these children will be deprived of love, supposed to be in the family. It's an injustice. I like the conclusion of this article. I take note of this. It said, none of your works will satisfy you without God. He satisfies you now with your earthly life and eternally in heaven. We can try to achieve justice, to right our wrongs in life, but nothing will ever come close. Because no matter how hard we try, we are eternally flawed without Christ. Our world will forever remain full of pain, full of heartache and sorrow. Because as one enemy is defeated, another will sprout back in its place. There is no way to win. If you think about it like that. Like, for example, we have what we have today, the ISIS and the Taliban and so forth, what is happening in the Middle East. What will be the end of this? When will it be? In fact, what is happening today that America is preparing for a bigger commotion that happened next year, that will happen next year, when there will be a change of administration. Especially if the Republican will win, there will be, they're expecting that more chaos will come. But that's another way of viewing. To view standing up against justice. One's action to reach out and turn this injustice around aren't futile. Yes, there may be not any completely transformative effect, like sex trafficking may not become completely obsolete, but doesn't one person's life make a difference? Of course, and one life is changed. Because I like the work of this crew, which is the Campus Crusade for Christ, and they are changing one after person to another. Just at the time of the survey, thousands of students have received the Lord Jesus Christ. Their lives have been changed. Being able to transform, save, and completely change the life of a person living a lifestyle of hurt and despair is worth the effort inserted into a passion that may seem like a dark hole. It's that sense of hope that fuels our daily battles to keep on trying, to press onward. And in the same sense, these injustices should become the battle to fight for. Without hope, there is really nothing that can be done. But in spite of our disappointments, right? It's very disappointing. We're going to disappoint all of this. You know, it's not just in the world, but even in our surroundings. Said, but in spite of our disappointments and heartaches over the injustices around us, life is still worth living. Would you say amen?
Amen?
Because we have a God who is just. We have a God who will give recompense in the end to everyone who has committed a sin. Life is still worth living. Live to enjoy His blessings. Would you say amen?
Amen?
And be a blessing to others. People who are blessed with and by your life will give grace to our God. Who is just.
Amen.
Life is worth living in spite of all this incompleteness, injustices, and disappointing and heartaches that is around us. We have a God who is the God of love and the God who is just. I'm so happy. You know, we have met new friends and now in Facebook. We're so happy with the tour and I gained weight in our tour for 7 days. I'm eating in the hotel every day. It's morning and evening, it's buffet. And then I sit with this guy who is very fatherly. They're couple and very fatherly. The wife is very motherly. And Abel,
He's a retired colonel in the military who served in Vietnam War. And I ate. Kain kami na ganyan. And I will say, I'm going to eat as if it is my last day. So I eat. Live to enjoy God's blessings and be a blessing to others. As if it is your last opportunity. Because you know, if people are blessed by your life, they are going to praise God. And when you hear them, of course, it will give you a pat. Yeah? Medyo tataba din yung puso mo. Right? Yeah, but it is a joke. It is because you have been a blessing. Because you have lived your life. Life that is worth living. Thank God for Jesus Christ. Share the Lord Jesus Christ to others. It's only God who can make us worth living. Amen? Father, we would like to thank you for word. We would like to thank you even for this encouragement. Times you may have to think, especially what is going on, and even what others, they say that there will be more chaos, there will be more heartache, there will be more pain. It's sometimes very discouraging. And we have been to ask